course, I had to play that song. I'm so sorry, but every time I talk about work, I hear that song in the back of my head. Anyway, work is something we measure in physics, and it is a measure of how much change you cause when you apply a force to an object. We can calculate work fairly simply. The symbol for work is just big capital W, and the equation is force times distance, and that D could also stand for displacement sometimes. They are kind of interchangeable here. Anyway, we measure work in something called joules. And no, not that kind of joule. This joule came first. And it is, the symbol for joule is just big capital J, and it's just what we measure all types of work and all types of energy with. Work is a scalar, so it's not going to have a direction associated with it, even though force and displacement definitely have directions. We measure work a little differently. So work can be positive or negative. And these two videos show examples of both of these. I want you to watch these for just a moment and see if you can figure out which one's which. So positive work, I'm gonna give you a heads up. Typically, whenever you experience positive work, there will be a gain in some sort of energy. And I know we haven't talked about energy yet, or maybe you watched the videos out of order, but there are different types of energy that exist, potential, kinetic, and we will get into that in another video. So the force out of these two that's causing a gain in energy would be this picture of the guy throwing the confetti. This would be an example of positive work because he's applying a force to the confetti, causing it to gain energy. It's gaining kinetic energy. It's moving. Whereas Evan Longoria, this video of Evan Longoria supposedly catching this ball headed straight for them barehanded, would be an example of negative work. He is causing that ball to stop. He is causing it to lose energy. So that would be considered negative work. So this would be a loss of energy. For those of you that maybe want a more concrete way of deciding whether or not something is positive or negative work, we can look at the direction of the force compared to the displacement. So positive work occurs only when the force and the displacement are in the same direction. And the negative work, the only difference is force and displacement are typically in opposite directions. So if we go back to our examples up here, when the guy is throwing the confetti, he is applying a force upwards. And that distance that the confetti moves is also upwards. Evan Longoria, you can see, applies a force sort of backwards. But that ball is moving this way, you'll see when we replay the video again, into Evan Longoria's hand. That force and that distance are in opposite directions, so this would definitely be considered negative work, whereas this would be considered positive work. And if you notice, in each of these examples, they're both considered work, and a way I can describe both of those directions would be parallel. So the big idea here is no matter what kind of work, work is only done when force and displacement are parallel to each other. And I like to think of it as the force that you're talking about has to be the one causing the change. So at any given time, there's lots of forces acting on an object. The force that's actually causing the change experienced by the object is the one doing work. So let's look at some examples because this is kind of tricky. In this first example, we have a person applying a force on an object, but this object is remaining still. It's not moving. It's not experiencing a change. Since there's no change, no work is being done. And if you need more concrete information, there's the equation. If my distance is zero, my work will end up being zero. In this next example, we have a force pulling this water skier to the right, and he is moving to the right. Since this force is causing the change experienced by the water skier, I would say that that applied force or that tension force, whatever you want to call it, is doing work. And I would say it's doing positive work because there is a gain in energy. Now in this next example, it gets a little trickier. I know everyone's favorite thing. You can see that this force is applied at an angle. And typically, what do we do when we see something existing at an angle? We break it into its components. So I'm going to zoom in on this picture, and you can kind of see they gave an equation for how I would break it into its components. And these symbols are a little funky. Don't overthink them. We're not going to use them, but I am going to point them out to illustrate a concept. This little symbol right here, that upside down T, is just the symbol for perpendicular. That is the perpendicular component, or what we've been calling it in class, the Y component. And this one, that symbol, is the parallel symbol. So they're saying the force parallel, or we can call this the X component. Now they kind of already gave us the answer, but if I break this applied force into its components, I can see which component is actually causing the change. Because the force as it is now is not parallel to the distance, so we could say that it's not doing work. But that force is definitely causing the lawnmower to move, so we know at least some part of it is doing work. And that would be this parallel component right here, the X component. You can see that the X component is pushing it to the right. And the lawnmower is also moving to the right. So it is definitely causing the change. While she is pushing it down, and there is a Y component, she's pushing it down into the ground, and the lawnmower is not moving vertically. It's not moving up or down, so there's no change being caused by that Y component. So that Y component is not doing work. So I would say there is positive work happening, but only the X component is doing work in this scenario. So I have one more example for you. We have a waitress carrying a tray across a room. So whenever you're trying to figure out whether or not work is being done, you need to think about the force that they're talking about. So the force in this question is whether or not her carrying force, you can think of it, is doing work. So that force is up in this case. She is pushing that tray upward. She's holding it up. But what direction is that tray moving while she's carrying it? It's moving sideways. So, by what we know with work, we know no work is being done because this specific force we're talking about, her applied force, is not causing the change. It's not pushing it sideways. Now, what is causing it to move sideways? We can maybe say her pushing herself across the floor. We could also say maybe friction force is holding the tray in place. There's a lot of things we could say is maybe causing the change or doing the work. But the big thing here is the force in question, this applied force up here, is doing no work because they are not parallel to each other. So here is an example of some math you might see involving work. So a student lifts a box of books that has a mass of 18.9 kilograms. That box is lifted at 0.8 meters at a constant velocity. So remember when we had forces before and we saw that phrase constant velocity, that meant that the net force is zero. All of the forces acting on an object are equal to each other. Just something to keep in mind. How much work did the student do? So work is typically force times distance. And they didn't give us a lot of information. They just gave us mass and the height it was lifted. I guess that could be a distance. So we are going to do that as our distance. But they didn't really give us a force. Let's take a moment to draw the free body diagram. So let's say we are lifting this box of books, this applied force, and then there would be a force of gravity acting on the books. And I think that would be it. The thing I know about both of these forces, since I know the net force is zero, is they have to be equal to each other. They have to be balanced. So in this case, that applied force that is doing the work is exactly going to be equal to the force of gravity. So I could say work is equal to force of gravity times distance, which means I could plug in this old force of gravity equation, if you remember it. So work would be equal to mass times the acceleration of gravity times the distance, because this is just the equation for that. Now I have enough information to solve. So if you plug all of this into your calculator, you should get a number. Oops. Calculator error. Give me just a moment. And I got about 148 joules. And if we were being good and rounding to proper sigfix, I would maybe round that to about 150 joules of energy, or of work in this case. Great. I have another hypothetical question for you, and then this video will be over. So let's say here you are. Pretty happy, nice day. You're outside practicing social distancing, and you come across this hill that you want to get to the top of. And there's two paths to get to the top of the hill. There's path A, we'll call it. And it goes right up alongside of the hill. It's a very steep path, but it gets you straight to the top. And then there's path B. Path B starts at the bottom, and it's a little more winding. And it kind of is not as steep. It just kind of gradually takes you up to the top of that hill. Less steep of a slope. Which path would you take? A lot of people would say they would choose B, just because it's easier. You're not trying to work that hard, you're not trying to climb up a steep side of a hill, so you're just trying to have a nice leisurely pace. But which one requires more work? The answer is they both require the same amount of work. Because the only thing that's changing in this person is the height. The height they are climbing is the same for each of the scenarios. You ultimately end up at the top of the hill. So the change experienced by the person is the same. If we look at this work equation, and then we assume she climbs at, or he or she climbs at a constant velocity again, that equation will turn into the force of gravity times distance, so mass times the acceleration of gravity times height. Your mass is the same in both of these examples, and the height you climb is the same, and the acceleration of gravity doesn't change, so the work is the same in both scenarios. So why would some people, if they're trying not to exert a lot of effort, take path B? Well, you are right, it is more effort to take path A. It's a greater force you need to apply to yourself to get your, to lift yourself against gravity and going that steep way. But it's a much shorter path to take path A. You get to the top pretty much immediately. Versus B, you might not exert as much force to slowly climb up the hill, but you take a much longer route to get to the top. So those kind of balance each other out, and you do end up with the same amount of work for both of these scenarios. Go ahead and practice what you've learned on to work or not to work worksheet, and watch another, there will be a help video posted for that.